Right, so one of the probably most important simplifications that one can do in hypersonics is to consider flows that are inviscid. And this is the title of the second chapter. Inviscid hypersonic flows. So why are we interested in this simplification? We are interested in this simplification because of the following. So if you consider again a body like this, right? Like this projectile here. And the Mach number is high. Then you're gonna have a shockwave emanating from the nose. And then here, for instance, in these corners, there is going to be expansion fans, expansion waves. So if in addition to this Mach number being high, the Reynolds number of this object, let's say based on a length L, the Reynolds number, which is the density multiplied by the velocity, multiplied by the length, and divided by the viscosity in the free stream. If this number is large, then it turns out to be that the pressure forces exerted on this object are actually high, are very large forces compared to the viscous forces. And that is because at high Mach numbers, the pressure variations in the field, they scale with the dynamic pressure. That the pressure variations scale as the dynamic pressure means that the pressure variations from the pre-shock gas to the post-shock gas are of the same order as the dynamic pressure of the free stream. So these variations, for instance, they generate a high pressure on this side facing the stream, right? Because there will be a pressure jump across the shock. And then they also generate a suction force on the expansion side. So just because of these pressure forces, there is a drag exerted on the body, and that drag is called wave drag. And this wave drag tends to be very important. It's just based on pressure. It doesn't have anything to do with friction. So it is convenient in many instances to examine the inviscid flow around this object in order to calculate the dominant mechanical loads. So these free stream inviscid flows that you see here, right? For instance, this streamline that will go away from the surface of the body, and then it would turn, and then it would turn again. And then it will face this recompression shock, and it will go again straight. This type of environment away from the object can be found actually in reality, as you're going to see in this slide. So in this slide, you see a Schlieren image of a T-38 aircraft in flight. So this actually is a real image taken from the ground with a special camera. In that image, you can see shock waves and expansion waves emanating from the fuselage of the airplane. So very far away from the airplane, where the flow is mainly inviscid, there are no disturbances. And then one can use the theory of shock waves, of inviscid flows, very close to the airplane and close to the fuselage surface. Then there are viscous effects, and there is going to be a boundary layer developing there in which the theory of inviscid flows is not valid. But at high Reynolds numbers, that boundary layer is very small compared to the size of the aircraft. So you can see another example in the next slide. So in this next slide, you have also supersonic flow over this object, and then you can see a shockwave emanating from the rings, actually the rim of the body, And then if you zoom in on the surface of the body, then you will see this high-speed boundary layer developing there. So let's say that in this chapter, we are going to be concerned only about the external flow, the flow that develops away from the surface, which can be approximated as inviscid. So in order to treat this flow, right, one is to consider also that, as I was saying in the last lecture, the post-shock temperatures tend to be high. So if you recall also from the last lecture that we're showing this diagram that you're going to see in the slides, there are thermochemical effects associated with hypersonics that complicate the problem by a lot. So there are some simplifications that they need to be made here. So for instance, if you look at this diagram, you have chemical effects entering in the problem through dissociation and ionization. So for the moment, we're going to disregard all of that. We are not going to enter into those processes yet. And we're going to consider, in particular, ideal gases that are non-reacting. Non-reacting ideal gas is a gas that obviously follows the equation of a state of an ideal gas, where this gas constant is actually a constant, and it does not depend on the composition. So for gases that are not chemically reacting, for instance, for air, this constant is about 286 joules per kilogram Kelvin. So when one goes back to the slide and looks at this diagram, I think you will see also that in the literature, there tend to be many references to something that is called real gas effects. To talk about, for instance, thermochemical processes of dissociation and ionization. So this is some wording that is used in the literature, and I'm not going to use this wording because by real gas, what is typically understood outside of the hypersonics community is the effect of the long-range attractive forces in a gas when it is at high pressure. So for instance, when one has to use a modified equation of a state like the van der Waals equation of a state to treat those attractive forces or a gas that is close to a phase change. So in hypersonics, even though there are high pressures that may send the pressure above the critical value of for that particular gas, the temperatures are also high. So in general, the gases that participate in hypersonics, they tend to behave as ideal, even if the local pressure is high. And that is because the temperature involved in hypersonics tends to be high. So this is going to be the first hypothesis that we're going to be using. We are going to be using ideal gases. So I also, in the last lecture, we talked about an equation, right, that could be derived when the flow is isentropic. So when the flow is isentropic and is steady, then isentropicity can be written as the directional derivative of the entropy is equal to zero. And that is to say that if you have streamlines like this, each one of those streamlines is going to carry one value of the entropy. But that variation of entropy is going to be always perpendicular to the velocity gradient. So that is to say that along a coordinate, a tangential coordinate, tangential to the streamline, which we could denote as L, the partial variation of the entropy with respect to that L is zero. So that will be the case of an isentropic flow. And I was able to derive that by combining momentum and energy, one can arrive to the result that the enthalpy plus the specific kinetic energy is equal to a constant. And this constant depends on the streamline, right? And this constant is called a stagnation enthalpy. So this is the Bernoulli's equation for compressible flows. So I'm going to continue today talking about this. One another development that can be made in order for us to understand basic aspects of inviscid hypersonic flows is to investigate how the state variables are related along a streamline, for instance, in an isentropic flow. And in order to do that, what one needs to do is to write down the first principle of thermodynamics. So if I go and I write down the first principle of thermodynamics, this will give me that T multiplied by the differential of the entropy is equal to the differential of the internal energy plus the pressure multiplied by the differential of a specific volume. So by using the definition of the enthalpy, I can also rewrite this first principle in the following manner. TdS is equal to the differential of the enthalpy minus the differential of the pressure divided by rho. So I have these two equivalent forms of the first principle. If I want to look at flows that are isentropic, then what one could do is to eliminate the variations of entropy. And if on top of that, in addition to assuming that the gas is ideal, I assume that the gas is calorically perfect, then I can express, for instance, the internal energy as the specific heat at constant volume multiplied by a temperature. And I can also express the enthalpy as a specific volume, as a specific heat at constant pressure multiplied by the temperature. So in a calorically perfect gas, again, to summarize, the specific heats are constant. So if I substitute these two definitions into these two equations, what I will have is that the Cp multiplied by dt for the second is equal to dp over rho for the second form of the first principle, and then for the first I will have that Cv multiplied by the differential of temperature is equal to the pressure multiplied by the differential of the density and divided by the density squared. So the only thing that I have done here is to develop this differential. Remember that here I arrived to these equations assuming that the flow was isentropic. So if I divide these two equations, I divide the first by the second, then what I will have is that Cp divided by Cv is going to be equal to the density multiplied by the differential of pressure divided by the pressure multiplied by the differential of density. This ratio that you see here, Cp over Cv, you are familiar with it because it is called the adiabatic coefficient. So I'm going to call gamma Cp over Cv. And this gamma, for instance, for a diatomic gas, is equal to 7 over 5, which is equal to 1.4. That will be for a diatomic ideal gas. And this is constant because Cp is constant and Cv is constant. So therefore, gamma is also equal to a constant. So this here on the side, right, Cp over Cv is equal to gamma, I could call it gamma. And then I could integrate this differential equation. I could say that the differential of pressure divided by the pressure is equal to gamma multiplied by the differential of density divided by density. And then I could integrate this equation from an arbitrary initial value of the pressure to the pressure, and from an arbitrary initial value of the density to another density. And then if I were to operate it here, right, these integrals are logarithms. So the final solution would be that the logarithm of the pressure divided by the initial pressure would be equal to gamma multiplied by the logarithm of the density divided by the initial density. Right, so it's a direct integral. And then from here, I could obtain that the pressure divided by the initial pressure is equal to the density divided by the initial density, power to gamma. So this equation here, with which you may be already familiar, is the equation of an adiabatic of an isentropic trajectory. And this equation here for an isentropic trajectory, what it does is to relate along a streamline, right? If I take a streamline, which is here, the pressure is P0 and the density is rho 0. So it tells me about the evolution of the pressure along this streamline. So somehow this other pressure here and this other density here, it needs to be related to this pressure P0 and density rho 0 through that isentropic. So I could do the same, and I could express, for instance, this density in terms of the temperature, right? So in order to do that, what I could do is to say this is equal to the pressure divided by P0 and multiplied by T0 divided by T, the power to gamma. So this is just by substituting here the ideal gas equation of a state. So here I could operate and I could arrive to the point that P over P0 power to 1 minus gamma is going to be equal to T0 over T power to gamma. Can rearrange this and express T over T0 as P over P0 power to gamma minus 1 divided by gamma. So this is the second form of an isentropic trajectory in terms this time of temperature instead of density. So if I go and I link this, these two equations with the Bernoulli equation, then I can have a relation between all these variables along the streamlines. In order to do that, I could take again the Bernoulli's equation. I'm going to rewrite it here. And I could express, for instance, this enthalpy for a calorically perfect gas. I could express it as Cp multiplied by T. And here I will have again the specific kinetic energy, and here I will have Cp multiplied by a stagnation temperature. Before doing this, right, and moving forward, let me just tell you that there is also an important quantity, and it's the speed of sound. So the speed of sound is for a non-reacting gas can be actually expressed as, I'm going to denote it as A, with the square root of the partial derivative of the pressure with respect to density at constant entropy. In order for me to perform this derivative, the only thing that I have to do is to substitute the pressure from this trajectory, from the adiabatic trajectory, from the isentropic trajectory. So what I would do is to say that this is the square root of the partial derivative or the derivative with respect to density of P0 multiplied by the density to gamma divided by rho naught to gamma. So I can do this derivative very easily, right? So this will be the square root of P0 divided by rho naught to the gamma, and then the derivative of rho to the gamma is just gamma multiplied by rho to the gamma minus 1. So what I could do again is to rearrange this as the square root of gamma multiplied by pressure. So here I would need a density, a pressure P0, and here I would need a density rho to the gamma divided by rho naught to the gamma, and then divided by rho. And if you identify this, right, this thing here, I'm highlighting there, it's just the pressure from this equation, because we just need to take the pressure to this side, and that will give me the pressure again. So could rewrite this as gamma multiplied by the pressure and divided by rho. And then here I could use again the ideal gas equation of a state. So by using the ideal gas equation of a state, this quantity will be gamma multiplied by the gas constant and multiplied by the temperature. So that's the form of the speed of sound for a non-reacting ideal gas. So you will see even later that when the gas is thermally perfect, right? And by thermally perfect, what one means is that it is described by the ideal gas equation of a state. but the gas is non-chemically reacting, but these CPs and CVs, they can vary with temperature. So that would be the case of a thermally perfect gas. For even for the case of a thermally perfect gas, the speed of sound still takes this form, with gamma depending on temperature. But that will be left for after. So this is the speed of sound, right? The speed of a sound waves in the gas. And if I want to come here to this other equation, right? And now what I do is to divide everything by CPT. So then what I will obtain is that T naught over T is going to be equal to 1 plus the velocity squared divided by 2 CP over T. So I know from a relation that I haven't derived here, but one could derive very easily by handling by operating with the first principle, that CP and CV are related to RG and to gamma in the following manner. From the Mayer's, what is called the Mayer's relation. It says that CP minus CV is equal to the gas constant. And this is actually valid also even if CP and CV depend on temperature. So CP minus CV is equal to the gas constant. So if I divide, for instance, this equation by CP, then what I would obtain is that 1 minus gamma is equal to RG over CP, or what is the same, this will be equal to gamma minus 1 divided by gamma. So I can go here, right, and for instance obtain CP as a function of RG to be gamma RG divided by gamma minus 1. And substitute this value of CP into the denominator of this expression here. So if I do that, I would obtain that this is equal to 1 plus gamma minus 1 divided by 2 and multiply by the velocity squared and divided by gamma RG and multiply by T. So if you look at this denominator, this will be the speed of sound according to this definition here. And as a result, the velocity squared divided by the speed of sound squared, that will give me the Mach number. So just to summarize here, I have obtained that the T stagnation temperature divided by the static temperature is equal to 1 plus gamma minus 1 divided by 2 and multiplied by the Mach number squared. So this equation relates the stagnation temperature T naught with the static temperature T as a function of the local Mach number along the streamline. I could also substitute here, since this is for isentropic flow, I could substitute these isentropic trajectories. And then this would tell me that this same expression is also valid for the pressure, the ratio of the pressure to the stagnation pressure. Sorry, it would be the stagnation pressure divided by the pressure power to gamma minus 1 divided by gamma. And this would also be equal to the stagnation density divided by the density to gamma minus 1. And this would also be equal to the stagnation speed of sound divided by the speed of sound squared. So these relations that you see here are fundamental in gas dynamics. And these relations are valid for an isentropic flow, right? The flow needs to be isentropic, and the gas here needs to be calorically perfect. So when the gas is not calorically perfect, there are not expressions as easy as these ones. And you will see towards the end of the course too that when the gas is not calorically perfect, the importance and the relevance of the Mach number as a parameter automatically appearing in the formulation is lost. So there is also another development that one needs to take into account here, and is that one can calculate an expression of entropy for a calorically perfect gas. So if one goes back to the first principle of thermodynamics here, One can also calculate an expression for the entropy for a caloric perfect gas. So instead of setting this to zero, I would integrate that equation. I would just need to integrate that TdS will be equal to Cp multiplied by dt minus Vp divided by rho. So the only thing that I want is to do here is to divide by the temperature, right? Dividing by the temperature, here divide by the temperature. For this one, could use the equation of a state, and turns to be that rho t is equal to the pressure divided by the gas constant. So you're gonna allow me to erase rho t here and put a pressure there and put an RG in front of all of this. One can actually directly calculate or integrate this equation because Cp is constant and RG is constant for a caloric perfect gas. So if I integrate this equation from an arbitrary initial entropy to the entropy, from an arbitrary initial temperature to the temperature, and from an arbitrary initial pressure to the pressure, then one would obtain an equation for the entropy that is S minus S naught is equal to Cp multiplied by the logarithm of T over T naught minus Rg multiplied by the logarithm of P over P naught. So one can operate, leave this expression like that, or can operate with it using the trajectories for a, or trying to express this in terms of a trajectory of an isentropic flow. And I can probably let you operate with this and show that the an alternative expression of the entropy variations will be S minus S naught divided by the specific heat at constant volume will be equal to the logarithm of the pressure divided by the density to the gamma, divided by P naught, divided by the density to the gamma. So this is an expression of the variations of entropy, normalized with the specific heat at constant volume. And you can see here that if the flow is isentropic, this ratio, right, the ratio of P over rho to the gamma to P naught over rho naught to the gamma would be 1 if the flow was isentropic. And as a result, the logarithm of 1 would be 0. So this expression trivially tells me that when the flow is isentropic, and in other words, when it follows this isentropic trajectory, the variation of entropy is equal to 0, right? But still, I can calculate the variation of entropy using this expression. So it is important here to notice, if one looks at this expression here for isentropic flows, is that one can distinguish between static and stagnation, for instance, temperature, static pressure, and stagnation pressure. So there is something that one shouldn't say, and is that the stagnation pressure is actually defined by this equation here. So what one shouldn't say is that the stagnation pressure is equal to the pressure plus the specific kinetic energy, as one is used to do at low Mach numbers. So this would look like a total pressure, right? Like a total pressure here. So the word stagnation and total are equivalent in this context, but perhaps for a student of subsonic aerodynamics, the stagnation pressure is given by this equation. Well, this equation does not apply at high Mach numbers. At high Mach numbers, the stagnation pressure is defined by this equation here. So P naught over P power to this exponent is equal to 1 plus gamma minus 1 divided by 2 multiplied by the Mach number square. Actually, one can realize that for small Mach numbers, that equation collapses onto this one. And it's not difficult to see. So for instance, if I take here P naught over P, and I say that this is equal to 1 plus gamma minus 1 divided by 2 multiplied by Mach square, and all of this is power to gamma divided by gamma minus 1, right, just by taking this equation here. So one can actually perform an asymptotic expansion here for low Mach numbers. Under asymptotic expansion, we say that this equation is equal to 1 plus gamma divided by 2 and multiplied by the Mach number squared. So if I multiply all this expression by the pressure, right, then I will have that pressure P naught is equal to P plus gamma multiplied by the pressure multiplied by the Mach number squared and divided by 2. So in this expression, you can actually see by substituting the Mach number, definition of the Mach number and the definition of the speed of sound, you're going to find that this is equal to P plus rho multiplied by U squared divided by 2. So in other words, this equation here that we have derived for isentropic compressible flow is equivalent to the classic Bernoulli equation for subsonic aerodynamics in the limit of small Mach numbers. But one should never use this equation for calculating the stagnation pressure at hypersonic Mach numbers. Another thing that one needs to take into account in this equation is the following. So if one looks at this equation for a given value of the stagnation temperature, as the Mach number increases, the static temperature must necessarily decrease, and the static pressure must necessarily decrease. So this is to say the following. If I go back to this sketch, if, for instance, I have here a reservoir of air upstream from where there are streamlines emanating, and this is the stagnation temperature, as the flow is accelerated, along these streamlines, what happens is that the temperature drops. And that makes sense because there is a transformation of thermal energy that was initially here in the reservoir into kinetic energy. And as a result, the temperature must decrease. This effect is actually crucial in hypersonics. And this effect connects very well with the history of the early developments in hypersonics that we're going to see in this slide. So this is a chart that relates the Mach number, approximate value of the Mach number, with the year. So this is just for high-speed flight systems. And one can plot the approximate Mach number versus year for several of these systems, right? So on the top left corner, you're going to see that this entire graph emanates from one point, which was the V2 missile in Germany. So just to give you some background about this point there, we are talking about the first period, the first historical period of hypersonics. And during this period, the first experiments in hypersonic wind tunnels were performed, as I will show you in a second. This first historical period could be called rocket power artillery in World War II. And two main characters in the development of this first historical period of hypersonics were Major General Don Berger and Von Braun. So Don Berger was one of the chief developers in the rocket division of the German army before and during the Second World War. And Von Braun was a scientist in working for Don Berger. And Von Braun did his PhD thesis on the development of rocket combustors before working for the German army. These two gentlemen came to the United States after the Second World War with the Operation Paperclip. So Walter Domberger worked for Bell Aircraft for many years, and then for North American Aviation. And Von Braun is well known to have played a central role in the space program in the United States during the 60s and 70s. So these two gentlemen actually were responsible for the development of the V2 missile So this V2 missile was a relatively small rocket, and it was a single stage rocket. So the length of his rocket was about 16 meters, and the maximum diameter was about 1.4 meters. So this rocket was a single stage, and the explosive that was hosted in the nose cone was amatol, which was a mixture. It was actually an explosive made of ammonium nitrate. This nose cone was actually protected by a shield, by a steel sheath of 6.9 millimeters of thickness. This missile had a range of 250 kilometers. That was enough for launching it from the, for instance, from Belgium or the Netherlands and crossing the English Channel. So the interest of the development in Germany, the interest of Germany in the development of these weapons was to have a long-range artillery weapon capable of stabilizing the tide of war in the Second World War. So the early developments of hypersonics were not related to the space program or anything like that. It was actually related to the development of terror weapons. This missile could reach a Mach number of about 4.4 to 5. So it was on the verge of getting into the hypersonic range. The skin temperatures that were reached on the surface of this missile during flight were about 950 kelvins. So that temperature is much lower than the melting temperature of steel. So as a result, Don Berger and Von Braun and their team didn't have to worry too much about handling the thermal loads on the missile, or didn't have to worry too much about the surfaces of the fuselage of the missile, because actually the missile was still suborbital, so it was not subject to strong re-entry thermal loads. So most of the developments during this time were related to rocket propulsion and guidance. And most of those developments that were later injected into the United States space program. So during the Second World War, Hitler actually poured a lot of money into the development of classic artillery weapons, including tanks, right? Many other weapons, cannons for a shorter range artillery. And by doing that, what they did unawarely was to stall many advanced programs that were taking place at Peenemünde. Peenemünde was a military base, a testing base that was in the north of Germany on the Baltic Sea. And there were developments being made by Von Braun in the what was called the Projects Group office. Now he was in charge of very advanced programs beyond the V2. And some of those programs involved the A4B, the A9 and the A10, and they were wing versions of the V2. And those wing versions of the V2 were designed such that if, for instance, this is cross range, this is down range. So this is the distance from the launching point. Then the trajectory of the, and this altitude, the trajectory of the missile for those newer versions of the V2 would be thought to be this, like launch, then exiting the atmosphere briefly, and then re-entering the atmosphere in sort of a skipping trajectory, in which the missile would go down first, and it would generate lift, and then it would go down again, and it would generate lift, and so on and so forth, in such a way that this cross range until impact, sorry, in such a way that this down range until impact could be much longer than for a normal V2. For a V2, this downrange was about 250 kilometers. But for an A4B, the planned range was about 4,000 kilometers. And this range was enough for hitting the continental, striking the continental United States from a base in Europe. So during this re-entry, this skip re-entry that is called, Von Braun and his team calculated that the Mach numbers necessary for this trajectory were about from 7 to 10. So that Mach number was much higher than the Mach number of the V2. And that brought into the problem the need of testing experimentally models of missiles at high Mach numbers, how to test that in ground facilities. So during these years, there were many developments on ground facilities for testing hypersonic flows. So perhaps at the forefront of the technology, definitely, was the were the tunnels in Peenemünde. So here, for instance, you have a picture of the Mach 4.4 wind tunnel in Peenemünde with a cross section of 40 by 40 centimeters. So this tunnel was used by Rudolf Hermann, was the director of the Institute for Aerodynamics in Peenemünde, to test in 1943-1944 models of the V2 and the A4B. For instance, here you have a model of the A4B in the supersonic wind tunnel, and there you can see shock waves and the pattern of the flow around this missile, and also the V2. So, however, with the intention of developing these sort of intercontinental vehicles that now they are actually called more than 70 years from this time, they are actually now called boost, glide weapons. So boost, glide, hypersonic weapon that can actually be boosted to orbit and then glide down to the target. So these boost glide weapons, they were based on earlier concepts by Sanger. So in 1934, Sanger, who was an Austrian aerodynamicist, wrote a famous paper describing what was called an antipodal bomber that was capable of traveling from Europe to the United States through an skipping trajectory like this. So during those years, the pressure built up for developing ground facilities capable of testing hypersonics, whereas this tunnel in Peenemünde was only capable of going up to Mach 4.4. So plans were made to build a much larger wind tunnel capable of developing hypersonic flows in the range of Mach 7 to 10. So the problems then arise there. And for instance, if one performs here a very fast calculation. So if one takes, for instance, a flow at Mach 10, let's say U infinity, Mach 10 in the stratosphere, this will be around 3 kilometers per second with a density in the stratosphere that is approximately 10 to the minus 2 kilograms per meter cube. The stagnation enthalpy for this flow is a suborbital stagnation enthalpy and can be calculated just as U squared divided by 2. So this would just be 3 kilometers per second squared. So this would be just 9 multiplied by 10 to the 6 divided by 2. So the power per unit area that is carried by this flow can be simply calculated by taking the density rho infinity multiplied by U infinity and multiplied by the stagnation enthalpy. So this number here, if you calculate this number with this Mach 10 flow in the stratosphere, it's going to give you something like 100 megawatts per meter square, approximately. So this is to say the following is that this flow is carrying a power per unit surface of 100 megawatts per meter square. The intention of the German army was to develop a hypersonic wind tunnels of 1 meter cross section. And one of the models is actually shown here. was a continuous wind tunnel. So in order to move continuously this hypersonic flow, one would require a power of about 100 megawatts. So those 100 megawatts are comparable to the power developed by a hydroelectric power plant. As a result, after realizing of this huge amount of power that was required for moving a hypersonic flow, it was decided to move the tunnels from Peenemünde to another location in Bavaria that was very close to a hydroelectric power plant that was in Kochel in Bavaria. Well, that tunnel, while it was being built, there were actually bombings by the Allies during the Second World War, destroying those plants. And while that tunnel was being built, another aerodynamicist in Peenemünde that was playing with the 4.4 Mach wind tunnel was capable of modifying this tunnel by changing the nozzle for a much higher aspect ratio nozzle and by elevating the stagnation pressure of inflow. This tunnel that you see in the screen was actually what is called a blowdown wind tunnel. A blowdown wind tunnel is a tunnel that has a spherical deposit at the end. In the case of the Peenemünde wind tunnel, this sphere was 12 meters in diameter. And then this sphere is connected with a test section. This test section is connected to a plenum by a converging divergent nozzle. And this plenum is ingesting air from the outside. So here is the test section. And how that tunnel used to work is that they vacuum pump this sphere, this huge sphere, to very low pressures in such a way that the flow will go isentropically through this section, through the nozzle, and then through the nozzle it would accelerate, and then here in the test section they will have the model. Well, what happened in this test section is that because of the acceleration that I was mentioning here, the temperature will go down. There will be very low temperatures in this cross-section of the order of 70, 60 kelvins. While they were ingesting here air at ambient temperature, the temperature in the experimental test section was very low because of the acceleration. So that was posing a limit in the capabilities of hypersonics, because the more the flow is accelerated, the smaller is going to be this temperature, and as a result, there were effects related to condensation. So in 1943, an aerodynamicist in Peenemünde, his name was Erdmann, Siegfried Erdmann, was capable of modifying the Mach 4.4 tunnel and transforming it into a Mach 9 tunnel. Mach 9 tunnel, which will be plagued by condensation. So the first experiment in hypersonics happened in 1943 after the modification of Erdmann of his wind tunnel and were plagued by condensation. Still, he was capable of taking the first pictures ever seen of a hypersonic flow experiment in a wind tunnel. This is this one that you have in the screen. So here you have a cone in cylinder object in the hypersonic wind tunnel of Peenemünde at Mach 9. So here in front of you, you have probably the first picture ever taken of a hypersonic flow experiment in a wind tunnel. It is remarkable that it took the United States 5 years until 1947 to develop technologies that were similar, were on par with the technologies developed in Peenemünde. And it was until 1947 that a tunnel was built in Langley. It was the 11 by 11 inches tunnel in Langley. That was a hypersonic wind tunnel at Mach 7 and dealt with the problem of condensation by using here an electric heater to increase the temperature of the inflow and therefore increase the temperature in the test section. But that didn't happen until 5 years after those experiments were done in Peenemünde. So needless to mention that all this progress in hypersonics came to a stop because of the end of the war, right, and because of the rates of the Allies in these facilities in Peenemünde and in Kochel. So the progress in hypersonics didn't fructify because of obviously the end of the war, and those facilities were destroyed. Well, coming back to here to the board, right? So now we have talked about the static and stagnation temperatures. There is also a couple of equations that they are important in inviscid flows, and we are going to derive them next. So let's just write here, for instance, the schematics of a shockwave. So there is going to be here a free stream, right? At a velocity U1. This stream, because of the shockwave, is going to get deflected like this. The velocity U2. Could also draw here two axes, one normal to the shockwave, and then decompose this velocity vector into a tangential U1t and a normal component, U1n. So those are the tangential and normal components of incoming gas velocity. And here I could do the same and decompose this exit velocity vector into a tangential and a normal component. Well, what is important here to notice is that there are two angles that are relevant for the discussion. So first one, right? So if I denote here with this red pencil the streamline passing through the shock, the streamline is going to go here, right? You're going to hit the shock, and then across the shock, the stream is going to be deflected. So that will be a streamline. There are two angles here that are important. The first one is this angle beta, and the second one is this angle delta. So beta is called the shock incidence angle. And delta is called the streamline deflection angle. We'll see a relation between these two later. But for now, let's try to obtain here relevant jump conditions across the shock. So in order to obtain those relevant jump conditions across the shock, what one can do is to draw here sort of a pillbox or a control volume. Could draw that control volume there, which is going to be infinitely thin. And then, for instance, define here normal vectors. Normal, 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 and normal, pointing outwards of the control volume. And then the question is, what happens with the velocity, density, temperature, and other variables across the shock? Well, in order for us to answer that question, we need to write down the conservation equations. So the first conservation equation that comes to mind is actually continuity. So I'm going to write the conservation equations in integral form. So for continuity, it would be that the time derivative of the volume integral of the density with respect to volume plus the surface integral of rho multiplied by the velocity multiplied by this element of surface is equal to zero. If the flow is steady, right, there is no mass accumulation in that pillbox, then this integral is zero. And then I only have to do this surface integral. This surface integral is trivial, because I only need to take into account what is the scalar product of the velocity with the normal vector. So for instance, on the face of this control volume that is towards the free stream, the pre-shock gas, then it's going to be minus rho 1 multiplied by U1n, the normal component. And then on the other face, it's going to be plus rho 2 multiplied by 2 U2n. This is going to be equal to 0. So the first equation that I obtain here is that rho 1 multiplied by u1n is equal to rho 2 multiplied by u2n. It's the first conservation law. And it tells me that the mass flux per unit surface is constant across the shock. Then the second constraint that I could obtain is from the momentum equation. From the momentum equation, what I could do is to write the integral form again. That would be the time derivative of a volume integral of rho multiplied by the velocity plus the surface integral of rho multiplied by the velocity multiplied by the velocity and multiplied by the element of surface. This will be equal to minus the surface integral of the pressure multiplied by the element of surface. And you may be wondering, why aren't you adding here viscous terms? Because across the shock is actually a source of dissipation, or the shock actually, what it does somehow is it alters the flow, because the flow is no longer isentropic from across the shock, right? Across the shock, obviously, the flow is no longer isentropic. So there is an internal region in the shock, within the shock, that can be described at not too high Mach numbers, right? And that internal region was described by Lighthill. That internal region involves the utilization of viscous stresses and of heat conduction. But remarkably, the cumulative effect of the viscous stresses and of heat conduction is zero. So when one integrates those effects across this surface, those effects are zero. So one does not need to add anything here. If the flow is steady, again, there is no accumulation of momentum, and then one only needs to deal with this equation. So for instance, in the normal direction, so this is a vector equation. So if I take just the normal direction, I would obtain that minus rho 1 multiplied by u1 n squared plus rho 2 multiplied by u2 n squared is equal to p2 minus p1. I'm projecting this equation in the normal direction and performing the integral. So as a result, in this normal direction, the conservation law that I will obtain will be that p1 plus rho 1 u1 n squared is equal to p2 plus rho 2 u2 n squared. This is the conservation of momentum across the shock. But again, this, even though it looks tempting to simulate this with a Bernoulli equation that the student is used to in subsonic aerodynamics, this equation has nothing to do with a Bernoulli equation. This is just the conservation of momentum across a shock. And this pressure plus this density multiplied by the velocity squared is not the stagnation pressure. So this is just the conservation of momentum in the normal direction across the shock. So I could also do the same thing in the tangential direction. In the tangential direction, the result will be that minus rho 1 multiplied by u1 normal multiplied by u1 tangential plus rho 2 multiplied by u2 normal multiplied by u2 tangential. That will be equal to 0. So if I use here the equation of continuity, the integral constraint of continuity, then I can cancel this rho 1 u1n and this rho 2 u2n. And then the tangential direction, the conservation of momentum would tell me that u1t, the tangential component of the pre-shock gas, is to be equal to the tangential component of the post-shock gas. And as a matter of fact, I've done my best here to actually draw these two arrows with the same length. I've done my best here to draw this arrow and this other arrow to have the same length, because the tangential conservation of momentum imposes that these two components should be the same. So I could also do something similar with energy. If I erase this. So for instance, if I write the integral equation, integral conservation equation for the enthalpy, that would tell me that the time derivative of the volume integral of the density multiplied by the enthalpy plus the specific kinetic energy plus the surface integral of the density multiplied by the stagnation enthalpy. Multiplied by the velocity and the element of surface. This has to be equal to the volume integral of the partial derivative of pressure with respect to temperature. Well, again, if the flow is steady, there is no accumulation of stagnation enthalpy. In that pillbox, there are no pressure variations. And then the flux of specific enthalpy, sorry, the flux of stagnation enthalpy has to be equal to zero. So this equation, in turn, will give me that minus rho 1 U1n multiplied by the enthalpy 1 plus U1 squared divided by 2 plus rho 2 U2n multiplied by H2 plus U2 squared divided by 2. All of this has to be equal to 0. So from continuity, I know that I can cancel these mass fluxes per unit. Put in the surface and then end up with this result that tells me that H1 plus U1 squared divided by 2 is equal to H2 plus U2 squared divided by 2. And this quantity here is equal to the stagnation enthalpy. So here one has derived the fact that the stagnation enthalpy is constant across the shock. And it's constant across the shock, even if the flow is non-isentropic. This equation here that you see is the energy equation, whereas the Bernoulli's equation for compressive flows that we derived before is the combination of momentum and energy. So it's actually a much higher constraint, only valid for isentropic flows. This one is actually valid across the shock. But the result is actually the same. This is the stagnation enthalpy, as I mentioned before, right? And one important detail of these equations is that nowhere in these equations we have stated whether the gas is calorically perfect, thermally perfect, or is chemically reacting. So these equations are actually general. The conservation of mass, conservation of momentum, and conservation of energy. Even if the gas was chemically reacting, the chemical reaction, the heat release could be incorporated here by modifying the definition of the enthalpy. The one thing that one can do with these equations is to reduce this system of equations to just two. So for instance, one could take the equation of continuity here and define here quantity is equal to this invariant rho 1 U1n, rho 2 U2n, and call it a mass flux per unit surface, right? I call m dot prime prime. This has units of kilograms per meter square second. Also, in this equation of energy, one can do the following, is that if you think about it, this U sub 1 square can actually be replaced by the normal component. And here it can also be replaced by the normal component only. And that is because here, if I expand this velocity square, here I will have one, the normal component square plus the tangential component square. And here I will have the normal component square 2 plus the tangential component square. Just by developing here these squares. So since the tangential components are the same because of the conservation of tangential momentum, then here in this expression for the conservation of energy, what I can do is to add here a subindex n without any loss of consistency, right? And then the kinetic energy, the only kinetic energy that matters for this quantity is just the normal component with the stagnation enthalpy understood as that. So if one comes to this to try to simplify these equations, the first thing that one can do is to substitute continuity, right? The constraint of continuity into momentum. So if one does that, then for instance, I could take this equation of momentum, and then substitute here the equation of continuity. So then one would obtain that P1 plus m dot prime prime squared divided by rho 1. Right, I will substitute here the definition of m dot prime prime. This will be equal to P2 plus m dot prime prime squared divided by rho 2. Could rearrange this equation in the following manner, saying that P2 minus P1 divided by 1 over rho 2 minus 1 over rho 1 is equal to minus m dot prime prime squared. And this equation here is called the Rayleigh line. Could do the following too. Could also take the the energy equation, right? Like this one. Substitute the continuity equation, this continuity constraint, and substitute also the constraint of momentum. So I could operate like that, but in the interest of time, I'm going to tell you what is the result. So the result will be an equation like this. It will be H2 minus H1 will be equal to P2 minus P1 divided by 2 and multiplied by 1 over rho 2 plus 1 over rho 1. So this is another important equation, what is called the Hugoniot curve. So these equations, they tell me that if I look at the shockwave, right, that's a sketch of a shockwave, once that this flux is imposed, these two equations, they represent constraints between the pressure, the density, and the enthalpy. So I have two equations for three unknowns, which together with an equation of a state will solve the entire problem. So if I look at this equation, and I look at these two equations, I see from the shape of this equation, right, that there is a solution that is possible when pressure P2 is larger than the pre-shock pressure. So when the post-shock pressure is larger than the pre-shock pressure. And in order to satisfy here this equation, necessarily this implies that the density of the post-shock gas is larger than the density of the pre-shock gas. And from this second equation, this also implies that the enthalpy of the post-shock gas is higher than the enthalpy of a pre-shock gas. Well, this sounds terribly similar to a shockwave. Some sort of compression wave, right, that is elevating the temperature and the density in the post-shock gases. But these equations also admit another solution, a solution in which the post-shock pressure is smaller and the pre-shock pressure and the density is smaller than the pre-shock density, and the enthalpy is smaller than the pre-shock enthalpy. So this would be an expansion sharp wave. Well, I think one can show that the expansion sharp waves cannot exist, and there is some reason that goes back to the second principle of thermodynamics. So from these two types of solutions, only shock waves can exist, can only be supported by the Rankine-Hugoniot relations. So the combination of these two equations are called Rankine-Hugoniot equations. So if I, for instance, assume that the gas is calorically perfect, and I normalize the pressure by using this pressure, this symbol, a capital pressure, the post-shock pressure by the pre-shock pressure. I also take the velocity and I normalize it by the pre-shock velocity. Remember, this is equal to rho 1 divided by rho 2. And then I also redefine this mass flow rate squared per unit surface by normalizing it with the pre-shock pressure multiplied by the pre-shock density, I also let you show that this parameter that is here is gamma multiplied by the Mach number of the pressure gas square. So I could draw here a diagram in terms of this non-dimensional velocity, this non-dimensional pressure, then the resulting shape of these curves in those dimensionless variables would be that the Rayleigh line would be p minus 1 divided by u minus 1. This would be equal to minus gamma multiplied by the Mach number square. And the Hugoniot curve would become gamma plus 1 divided by gamma minus 1 minus nu divided by gamma plus 1 divided by gamma minus 1 multiplied by v minus 1. And this would be equal to the pressure. Those would be the two equivalent forms of these two equations written in dimensionless form. Remember that if the gas is calorically perfect, I can replace the enthalpies by Cp multiplied by the temperature, right, using just the definition of the enthalpy. Well, if I plot here the Rayleigh line, for instance, I know that the Rayleigh line for sure is going to pass through the point 1, 1. And it's going to be a straight line. So this will be a straight line that could be, for instance, could be something like this. That will be the Rayleigh line with this first equation. And then the second equation is going to be a curve, right? Going to be a Hugoniot curve. This Hugoniot curve, in general, is going to intersect the Rayleigh line, and it's going to pass through the point 1, 1. So this will be the Hugoniot curve, whereas this one is the Rayleigh line. And both pass through 1, 1. The solution of the problem is the intersection of a Hugoniot curve and the Rayleigh line at a point, right? Point here, that will be the solution of a problem. So this will be the post-shock state. It is important to notice that these curves, they have four quadrants. So for instance, I have a quadrant here that cannot be accessed by the solution, by construction. I have another quadrant here that cannot be accessed by the solution by construction. And then I have these two other quadrants, one up here, right? That, for instance, I have that solution, and another quadrant down here that could be accessed if the slope of the Rayleigh line was different, for instance, to intersect a point here. Well, this quadrant here that will be representative of sharp expansion waves cannot be accessed either, because this solution in this quadrant would lead to the violation of the second principle. So that can be seen, for instance, if one plots here an isentropic curve. So an isentropic curve in this plot would look like something like this. Would look like a hyperbola. That would be an isentropic. So all these points in the first quadrant, they are actually above the isentropic, and therefore they are generating entropy. Whereas these points below the isentropic are actually reducing the entropy, which is not possible in an isolated system. As a result, this quadrant is impossible, and this solution predicted by the Rayleigh-Hugoniot equations, Rayleigh-Hugoniot equations, is impossible. So you cannot have any expansion sharp wave. Only shock waves can exist. Another important point that one needs to remember here is that this Hugoniot curve has an asymptote here. Right, when the denominator of this curve goes to zero, it has an asymptote, and this asymptote is equal to gamma minus 1 divided by gamma plus 1. So for a diatomic gas, this asymptote is equal to 0.16. If I substitute here gamma equal to 1.4. This number that you see here is actually very, very important in hypersonics. It's very important because it tells me the maximum density ratio that I can have across a shock wave. So remember that this V is also equal to rho 1 divided by rho 2. So as a result, the maximum ratio of densities that I can have over a shock wave, across a shock wave, is equal to gamma plus 1 divided by gamma minus 1. And this number is equal to 6 for a diatomic gas. We will see later that in hypersonics, in the hypersonic limit of these equations, this constraint of having a maximum achievable post-shock density plays an important role in the calculation of post-shock quantities.